Krishna Janajana Shakaya Chaksu Undamitam Yena Krishna Shri Guru Namaha. And now we wish you Bhagai Krishna Prasthaya Bhutanai Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Prasthaya Itinamne. Namaste Saraswati Devi Om Dhani Bhutanai Yen Krishna Sunni Rari Prasthaya Devi Sutanai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Paramahamsa Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sadasani Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare
Hare. In this life or previous lives, or if we come back again, whatever service is done to the Supreme Personality of Godhead remains there within our life. Our existence as a spiritual being is never lost by time. In this material world, our endeavors are subject to the time element. Our energy, time, and effort, and whatever we create, is eventually reduced and destroyed by the time factor. That's why the material world has nothing to offer except hard work. And so you work hard for something that you lose in the end anyway. And in the meantime, you're trying to enjoy what you get. But just a little devotion, a little time, energy, effort, and serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead will never be lost and remains there eternally. And as we build on this more and more, we become what we say more and more Krishna conscious, Balaram conscious. We become able to overcome. It's important to understand that success means spiritual advancement. Material advancement is not success. So material advancement will simply fortify the needs of the body, but will not fill the needs of the soul, the needs of the heart, the needs of the person. And so whatever endeavors we make in life should be directed to using our time and energy to serve Krishna. That is never lost. And it always is something that is, as is said in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, susukam kartam avyayam, that this process is joyfully performed. Sometimes we think, oh, I'm not feeling that joy we talk about. Or the joy that everyone talks about in the scriptures. But that is because we are still in a conditional state of consciousness. So, therefore, if one is sick, one thinks, what do I have to do to get well? Material life is a disease. It's actually said called Bhavarog. Bhavarog means disease. Anachya Sari Maya Vasi Abhar Lagi Harinama Mahamantra Mal Subi Ak Lagi. That Bhakti Vinod Thakur says, the living entity is asleep, sleeping on the bed of the material existence, trying to enjoy something, a little bit of happiness that comes with some material position, some family relationships, some something. But it is so insignificant that it says that one drop of spiritual happiness is enough to drown away every of the subtotal of all material happiness in all parts of the universe for all times. Spiritual happiness is happiness. So we're hearing about Balarama. So Rama means pleasure. Pleasure. And that aspect of the Supreme Personality of Godhead that helps us to awaken our natural pleasure existence. Everyone wants pleasure. Everyone wants that pleasure that doesn't end. Sometimes we say, oh, well, you know, life, you get a little pleasure here, you get a little suffering here, okay? But that is not normal. Nobody wants that. We resign ourselves or accept that. That's the way it is. And we develop a mindset that that's all we can get. Maybe a little happiness here, and most of the time we're struggling to bring it back or somehow avoid the difficulties of this world, which are so many. Just like the devotees did a test one time. How many ways you can find happiness in this material world, and how many ways you can suffer? Now, I think all of you should be able to understand which list was longer. This, I'll give you a very simple and quite ordinary example. Your small toe on your right foot, how much pleasure does that give you? Mr. Toe, down there, please give pleasure.
Okay.
But then again, how much pain can that toe cause you? So much. Now, this is a small example of how our body is designed simply for pain. That's all. But our soul is designed simply for pleasure. So when we accept pain as pleasure, we're neglecting who are we are and who where we can find our pleasure. So Lord comes, Lord Balarama, he is the reservoir of all pleasure, therefore his name is Rama. Balarama, one who gives strength and spiritual pleasure. Spiritual strength, spiritual pleasure. Or one who takes pleasure in spiritual activities. Or one who gives spiritual strength through the process of bhakti. So his name has many meanings. Today, we are celebrating his appearance day. The appearance of the Lord is a great form of celebration all over the world because it is rare and it's rare that the Lord comes to the material world. Very rare. He comes once in every 600,000 years, and he just happened to come 5,100 years ago. So it's interesting that we happen to be in this particular situation now to remember just recently, 5,000 years ago, in comparison to time, is really just like yesterday. It's not long ago that the Lord came in his form as Balarama and Krishna, of course. And then after that, again, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda. So when we look at it, in between that, those periods of time, the Lord comes in other incarnations, but doesn't teach the highest spiritual principles, nor the highest spiritual goals. So this is a very, how we say, auspicious time to be in this situation. Why? Because we have the chance to to gain the utmost, the highest spiritual attainment, which is to associate with Krishna in Sri Vrindavan Dham. And that was not available before when Krishna didn't appear. So, and of course, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda has broken open the storehouse of love of God and distributed the kapas to everyone. So, the Lord, he has two duties. He gives pleasure to his devotees in different ways, but he also kills demons. Is there any difference? Actually, we say, from the spiritual perspective, no. Because giving pleasure to devotees makes the devotees elevated and happy in their spiritual practice. Killing the demons gives them a chance to stop their demoniac activities and elevates them to the process of liberation. So the Lord is good, God is good, and whatever he does, whether he's killing or blessing, he is doing the same, because there's nothing, you can't find any darkness in the sun. There's no darkness in the sun. Whatever angle you look at the sun from, you always get light. So therefore, in the same way, whatever way anyone connects with God in any form, in any way, they are benefited. And when the Lord goes out of his way to remove irreligion by killing demons, then that person becomes, that demon becomes supremely fortunate. So, and Balaram was very enthusiastic to kill demons. there are many stories. He killed Palambasura. We talked about that when he was in Vrindavan. He killed Dainagasura. We spoke about his killing of Dainagasura. But he fought with other demons also. One of the demons was, let me see if I can find it here. Before I, Balaram was, he was there during the battle of Kurukshetra, but he didn't take the side of the Pandavas, nor did he take the side of the Kauravas. But he favored Duryodhana because Duryodhana was the student in learning the art of fighting. But when Balaram tried to make peace between Bhima and Duryodhana in the club fight, they wouldn't listen. They simply rejected him. And he became somewhat unhappy and disgusted, so he left. And he traveled for 20 years. And he visited all the holy places all over the area. And during that time, when he was traveling in different places, he came to one place called Namisarani. Namisarani is not far from Lucknow. Any of you from that area, Lucknow, India? Okay, Lucknow, yeah. You know where Namisarani is? It's by the bank of the, what is that river, Sarai River?
Sarai.
Yeah. So this place is a very holy place. It's actually the center of the universe. If you were actually to find the center of the universe, Namisaranya is actually the center of the universe. There's a place in Namisaranya where there's a big, what we say, tank of water. You could go there. It's, the tank of water is about as half the width of this room, wide, and the same, it's circular, it's about that big. Now, this tank is bottomless. There's no bottom to it. How is that? That one time there was a demon on earth, and Vishnu threw a chakra, his chakra, and it missed the demon and hit the earth and went through the earth and came out the other side. So when people come to that area, they take you know, holy water and get blessed from that. But when the British were in India, they doubted, because you know, the local people were saying this tank has no bottom. And the British said, oh, you know, they said whatever he said. And so they decided to make an experiment, and they took a long, long chain to see if they can, the chain would reach the end. They went down a mile and a half, and that's as far as the chain would go. There was no bottom. So, as far as we know by experiments, it's more than a mile and a half deep. But we understand from Shastra, it goes through the earth and comes out the earth. So this is Nali Sarani. It's a very, very holy place. And sages and saints gather there to discourse on subject matters of spiritual importance. So the sages and saints had a great, great gathering. And during that time, in order to facilitate their meeting together, they had to determine who amongst us is qualified to preside over this great assembly of saints and sages. So after debating and coming to some conclusion, they elected one person called Romaharshan Sutta. So Romaharshan Sutta was given the seat of honor, and he was the presiding guru of this great assembly of saints and sages. And he was a great personality. Now, Balarama is on tour, and he comes to this place of Nami Sharanya, where this gathering of thousands and thousands of sages. The sages recognize Balarama, and as soon as they see him, in order to honor him, they all stand up in reverence and greet him in the most wonderful way, except one person, Omar Sutta. He didn't get up. And so Balarama noted that. Now Balarama could understand this person is not qualified to sit on the seat of honor because he lacks the main thing, to honor the presence of the Supreme Lord when the Lord appears. So Balarama did something. He took a piece of kusa grass. You know what kusa grass is, right? You've seen kusa grass?
Yes.
Very sharp grass. What is it? Kusa grass is when Lord Varaha picked up the earth from the bottom of the Garbhodakshaya ocean and placed the earth back in its orbit. And then he was all wet, so he shook his body. And when he shook, the hairs of his body fell off and fell onto the earth. And those hairs grew as kusha grass. That's what kusha grass is. It's the hairs of the body of the Rahadev. You see, it's very sharp. Right? Yeah. So he took a piece of kusha grass and went up to Romaharshan Sutta. You can see the devotees have made this into a picture. And he touches Romaharshan Sutta in the head. And by doing that, he kills him. He dies right on the spot. So, the sages are becoming a little unhappy. We just elected him, and now God has killed him. What to do? So they made their petition to Balarama and said, you know, we understand you're God, and you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But and everything you do is perfect, but you know, you just kill our leader. So we need some help. Now Balarama said, I'll bring it back to life if you want. No, don't do anything you don't want to do. Don't do anything you don't want to do. So they were very respectful to Balarama. So Balarama said, okay, the son is the representative of the father. And therefore, his son was Sutta Goswami. And so we know from Srimad Bhagavatam that Bhagavatam starts off where Sutta Goswami is presiding over the sages at Nami Sharanya for this meeting of 1,000 years to determine what is the future of the living entities in the age of Kali. And they're discussing various subject matters. So Balarama gives the indication that the Son is considered to be an expansion of the Father, and therefore also can act in that role when the Father is not present. So Sudha Goswami was also highly qualified, so he was given that post. But there's an interesting point that is very much a philosophical idea that we should understand, and that is, when Balaram made a statement regarding Romaharshan Sutta, he said he is like a dramatic actor playing a part. In other words, his role as being the leader of the sages was not fully developed in love with God or in the qualities of being a leader. He was playing a role. So this is interesting, because in spiritual life, you're either there or you're not there. In material life, you can fake it. In material life, you can fake being something you're not, and people will also believe it. In spiritual life, you can fake it for a while. So therefore, the quality is not the position we have, but it's the bhakti we have. This is important to understand, because sometimes, and it's also natural, to regard a person advanced or more advanced according to whatever position they have within the society. Like sannyas or guru or temple leader are considered to be more advanced. But there's no statement anywhere in any shastras that says that position is the indication of advancement. Indication of advancement is the quality of one's heart. And when the heart is developed in love of God, that is the indication of one's advancement. And that is not relegated, or what we say, restricted to position. Position is an indication, but it's not the, what we say, the final understanding. Therefore, we see, and the point I'm trying to make is that every devotee in Krishna consciousness is respectable, because you don't really know how much a devotee has bhakti or not, simply by what role they play in the society. What role they play in the society. Sometimes for somebody who has no position, stays in the background, always engaged in doing devotional service, never wants any recognition or any position, is actually more advanced than anybody in their own spiritual development. So advancement is not based on position, but is based on the quality of a person's character and how that character is used in devotional service like that. So we really judge a person by their character. What is their, you know, they're exhibiting those qualities of bhakti. That's how we see it. Are they becoming humble? Are they becoming tolerant? Are they becoming prideless? Are they becoming indifferent to happiness and distress? Are they eager for service? Are they eager for hearing and chanting? These are the indications of a person's advancement in devotional service. So, but sometimes, and it's also natural to see things in terms of position, which is sometimes an indicator in itself, but not always. So Balarama wanted to make that point, that he's, although he's in the highest position, he's not qualified to sit there. And so Balarama could see through his pretentiousness and decided to purify him. So that's it. And then, now, Balaram said, you know, he was feeling a little like he needed to offer some service to the sages because he had eliminated their leader. So he says, he offered to somehow or other do something to, what we say, overcome or... Yeah. What's the word? Compensate for what he did. So the sages said, well, actually, we do have a problem. There's this one gorilla. His name is Davida. And he said, always, every time we begin our sacrifices and our meetings, he comes and he destroys it by throwing stool and urine all over the place. He's a nasty person. And so a lot of times when we start, he defiles the sacrifices. So please stay here and deal with him when he comes. So Balarama agreed. So after some time, Davida shows up, and he's really licentious, really quite gross. He starts making all kinds of terrible sounds, and then he starts passing urine and stool all over the place. Hare Krishna. And so now Balaram is seeing what's happened, so he challenges him to a fight. So there's a big fight. So they're fighting. And Davida is uprooting trees and swinging at Balaram. Balaram's picking up trees and fighting back. So they're smashing trees against each other. Pretty soon the whole forest is treeless. There's no trees left. Then they start picking up rocks and throwing it at each other. Balaram keeps one tree, and when Davida throws a rock, it's the original baseball. So the first baseball player was Balaram. He was hitting the rocks with the trees. And the fight goes on, and then, you know, Balaram's kind of just having some fun. Because it's no fun when the girl, the demon comes and he gets killed right away. I mean, there's no adventure in that. And so to make it interesting, he makes a big fight out of it. And it's like a big dramatic performance. But the Lord is just playing around, having fun, and making the demon look good for a while. And then it's when it's time's up, he finishes it. And so at one point he smashed the rib on the head and he cracked his skull open and he died. They go, Jai Ho, Hare Krishna. Nobody's cheering. Gotta cheer Balaram, he's on our side. Unless you have sentiment for Derrida, I don't. Poor gorilla. Oh. Not like that. So yeah, this is Balaram. And then the sages congratulated Balaram, they gave him so many gifts, so many presents, and then Balaram went on. And he visited so many holy places. He visited Vrindavan. But he didn't go one place. He didn't go to Jagannathpuri. He passed by that area, but didn't go to Jagannathpuri. Why didn't he go to Jagannathpuri?
Because he's there already?
Yeah. Because he didn't want to see himself being worshipped at Jagannathpuri, because he's there in the form of Balaram. Yeah. So he very strategically passed Jagannathpuri not to, you know, see himself in the process of being worshipped. And so he went to different holy places and performed penances, took bath, and traveled for 20 years. 20 years. And then at one point he returned to, this is all mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam, he returned to Kurukshetra after traveling for 20 years. There was one lady, her name was Revati, and her father's name was Kukudli, I think. His name was King Kukudli, yeah. And he had this beautiful, beautiful qualified daughter named Revati. Now, Revati had so many suitors that wanted to get married. So, King Kukubi wanted to give his daughter the best possible blessing. So what did he do? He went to Lord Brahma. He had the power to go, he was the king of the earth, and his daughter was a highly qualified princess. He took his daughter with him to visit Satyaloka, where Lord Brahma lives. Brahma was busy. He was engaged in a dramatic performance, so he wasn't able to meet the king right away. So it says a moment passed, and after a moment he came out and met the king. The king offered nice prayers to Lord Brahma, glorified him in so many ways. Finally, Brahma said, "See, when you meet a glorious person, you never speak about what's on your mind. First you say some nice words, you say you offer something. Then, or by pleasing the person by then, he's inclined to give you what you ask for." This is very strategic. But it's also etiquette like that. So even when we go before the deities, before we ask the deity for something, we should always glorify the deity, offer gifts to the deity, worship the deity, and then after that, then you say, "My dear Lord, I come for a reason." What's that? There was one lady in London. Should I tell you this story?
Yes.
They told me I couldn't believe the story anyway. She, you know, our London temple is quite big. On Janmashtami, we get 65,000 people coming for the program. On Ram Nomi we get 65,000. Janmashtami is smaller.
Oh, wow.
Janmashtami is for about 50,000. So there's such a large, large Indian community. So one lady, she's there, and she wants to ask the Lord for some blessings. So she has a son. The son's going to school, and this boy has 10 subjects. And she's really concerned that her boy has the highest marks. So she goes in front of the Radha Kulananda in London and prays, "My dear Lord, please give my son 10 A's." That was her prayer. So she made the prayer, did everything else, and then the boy got 9 A's, not 10. She came back and said, "My dear Lord, you didn't hear my prayer right. I asked for 10 A's and he only got 9. What to do? Krishna messed up. So this is not the kind of prayers we're using, we're supposed to make to the Supreme Personality of God. Prayers are, "How can I serve you? How can I purify my heart so I can become a better devotee? How can I chant better? How can I develop better relationships with other living beings?" These are prayers that are what we say, acceptable. Going before the Lord and saying, "My dear Lord, you know, Rupam Dehi, Dhanam Dehi, Janam Dehi, what else? Dhanam Dehi, Yaso Dehi, Dehi." Dehi doesn't work. He's giving you everything. Don't ask for anything. Ask for devotion. We don't have to ask the Lord for anything material. Whatever you need materially, he'll provide. And if you don't get it, you didn't need it. So the Lord is not, what we say, posted to be a merchant where our payment is the prayer and his reciprocation is the merchandise. That's business. We don't have a business related. Our relationship with the Lord is, "How can I serve you? How can I become a better devotee?" These are the prayers that are actually beneficial and very pleasing to the Lord and very beneficial to the devotee. If you need something material, just keep it quiet and Krishna will give it to you or even you ask him. Because if you please him, Krishna says, "Oh, this person really needs this, but they're not asking me for it. I'll give it anyway." So when we please the Lord by our devotion, then the Lord wants to please a devotee. And Prabhupada says, "What can you hold in two hands that Krishna is giving at 10? And what can he keep in two hands that he's taking away in ten? So the program is never to ask for anything material, always ask for devotional service. And then the Lord always takes care of his devotees. He takes care of even the non-devotees through the material energy. But for the devotees, he does it directly. So there's no need to ask for anything. And sometimes you need something, and it's important that you have it. But the Lord will give it to you when the time is right. Just like I know, for example, this is something that I find very often. Husband and wife, both devotees, they want a child, but they can't have a child for some reason. And all their attempts at having a child fail. The doctors can't do anything. But after some time, with prayer and continuous endeavor in that direction, the most amazing child comes. Why? Because Krishna was waiting to give that couple that child, which was perfect in all respect. So what I'm saying is, using this as an example, Krishna knows what you need, when you need it. The Lord knows what you need, when you need it, not what you need right now. We make our prayer and we think, okay. It's like another prayer to the Lord is, one man, he wants money. He wants $1 million. So he goes to the Lord and he says, my dear Lord, I want $1 million, and if I get $1 million, I will give you half. And so he's enthusiastic. And so he tells his friend knows all about the prayer. So after some time, he gets $500,000. And then he gives nothing to the Lord. And his friend said, you promised the Lord half. He said, he already took his half. Indian business school. You heard of that? Hare Krishna. So no, that's not the way you approach the Lord. So we approach the Lord for something spiritual, how to purify the heart, how to chant better, how to develop the qualities that are conducive to our spiritual life. These are the real prayers. So when we make those prayers, we'll find we'll always be satisfied in whatever we do in life. So King Kumuda, he's waiting for Lord Brahma. Brahma comes out after one moment, and he's after worshiping Brahma really nicely. Brahma says, "How can I? What do you want? How can I please you? What is your request?" He says, "I have this beautiful daughter, and she's there, and there are so many persons on the earth who are qualified to be her husband. Can you choose one for me?" Brahma said, "They're all dead." That one moment in the higher planet was thousands of years on the Earth planet. So all of those persons who are candidates are all gone. In fact, everything is gone, even your kingdom. So, because time, the higher you go in the material world, the slower time is. So one moment on the heavenly planets is equal to 1 year in our planet. Because Krishna stole the cowherd voice and calves. I mean, Brahma stole the calves and calves. Brahma left for a minute and came back, and it was 1 year by our calculations. So 1 day is six months? Is it 1 day? Something like that. Anyway, the calculations, and so if you go all the way up to Brahma Loka, one moment is thousands of years on this planet. So he said, but now he's stuck. He doesn't have anybody for his daughter. So Brahma says, actually, I have the perfect person for you. His name is Balarama. So you can marry your daughter to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Balarama. So Balarama has two consorts, Kalindi and Revati. When Balarama saw his wife was bigger than he was. Usually that's a no-no, I guess. So she was big, so what Balarama did, he took her head and he pushed her down. And he made her shorter. It doesn't work with your wife. You know, she only decided to push you down, you know, so. So anyway, he made her shorter like that because she was from another yuga, which was Sachi Yuga, and Sachi Yuga people were very, very tall. Even when Krishna was here on the planet, Krishna was 14 feet tall. And some of the soldiers on the battlefield of Kurukshetra were 20 feet tall. They found Bhima's club not too long ago. It was buried in that area of Kurukshetra. The club, they couldn't even move it. It was so big and so heavy. So yeah, those soldiers on the battle of Kurukshetra were about between 15, 16, 20 feet tall. Krishna was 14, he was small. He was only 14 feet tall. So as time goes on, because of the age, people's size reduces, like, you know. And it says at the end of this age, people will be like midgets. Everyone will be like a midget. And so we do a reduction of size, reduction of bodily strength, reduction of compassion, reduction of longevity of life. All these things will be reduced as this age goes on. This is the age of there's so many deficiencies. So this Revati is an eternal consort of Balarama, and she appeared in this way to accept Balarama. Amen. So when Lord Nityananda appeared, he married two personalities. Lord Nityananda is Balarama again. He married Janava and Visuddha. One of them is Kalindi and one of them is Revati, who has appeared as Janava and Suddha. So he married his eternal consorts again in his lila as Lord Nityananda. Shall I tell you what happened?
That's weird.
I don't see too many heads. Most of you are in. No, I'm just kidding. So what happened was, Surdasarakela had a beautiful daughter, two daughters, named Visuddha and Janava. And he prayed to the Lord to get Janava married, because she was marriageable age at the time. And Janava was always having these dreams about marrying this great personality who she didn't know. And finally, it was recommended, this is a long story, since Chaitanya Bhagavat, and that he tried to marry his daughter to Lord Nityananda. And when Lord Nityananda was notified, that he immediately accepted it. And so he married Janava. Janava is a great personality. I think she is Revati, who has come again. And but she had a sister named Visuddha. Now Visuddha is not she's an interesting person. Because during the wedding ceremony, when everyone was there and the feast was being served, Visuddha was serving Lord Nityananda. And the ladies, they wear the veils over their head. So while she was serving Lord Nityananda, her veil fell back and she felt embarrassed that her head was not covered in front of Lord Nityananda. Now she's serving. She doesn't want to stop serving, so she manifests two other arms and she puts her veil over her head and continues with her serving. So Lord Nityananda sees that and says, I think I'm going to have two wives. So he marries her also. So by her, he has two children. One is Birabhadra, sometimes known as Birachandra, who is an incarnation of Shiranakshaya Vishnu. And the other one was a girl named Ganga Devi, who's the incarnation of the Lord Ganges. So these were born of Visuddha and Nityananda. And but Janava never had any issue. But she remained one of the most outstanding personalities in the whole Leela after the disappearance of Lord Chaitanya. She was considered to be the guru of all the devotees at the time. She was so exalted. So I think she's either the incarnation of Kalindi or Revati, I'm not sure. Both of them eternal consorts of Balarama who appeared to become the consort of Lord Nityananda. Because Lord Nityananda and Lord Balarama are the same personality. Prajendra Nandanaye, Sachi Sutta Vaidose Balarama Guru Rita. There's no difference between Nityananda and Lord Balarama. So, at one point, when Balarama was away from Vrindavan, he decided to return to Vrindavan and give his blood mercy to the residents. And Krishna was away also. So the residents of Vrindavan were suffering. So Balarama appeared in the month of Chaitra. Chaitra is the month of March, April. It's considered one of the most auspicious months of the year. The most auspicious month of the year is considered to be Kartik. The month of Chaitra also. That's why when weddings are performed in that month, or celebrations are performed in that month, Lord Ramachandra appears in the month of Chaitra. And there's many other ceremonies. Sometimes Lord Chaitanya appears also in that time period. It's a very auspicious month. So Lord Balarama took the opportunity to return to Vrindavan during that time. And Balarama has his own set of gopis, which are separate than Krishna's set of gopis. So Balarama performed the rasa dance when he was there. He stayed for 2 months. And during that time, he gave pleasure to all the residents of the Vrindavan for 2 months. And during that time, Balarama danced the rasa dance. And Balarama, he likes to do unusual things. And one of the things he likes to do is he likes to get intoxicated. And so there's a particular beverage called Varuni. It's honey liquor. It's made from the sap of a tree, and then it's distilled and comes in the form of a liquor, which is very sweet. And Balarama loves to drink that. Like that. So Balarama, one time, he decided to get some Varuni beverage. That's what's called. And so they gave him some Varuni beverage, and he became a little bit tipsy. But not really. And so he started to chastise Lord Indra. "You Indra, you plaything of Sachi." Because the moon kept moving, and he was blaming Indra for the moon being not in one place. But the moon was in one place. Balarama was just a little, wasn't seeing things correctly. Hope I don't get smashed for this one. So, and he says, "You plaything of Sachi." And Sachi is Indra's wife. So he was chastising Indra. And so then he gets intoxicated. Now he's with his gopis and he wants to take a bath. So he goes to Jamuna and he calls Jamuna. But Jamuna says, "I think he's intoxicated, so I'm not coming." So she hesitated and didn't appear. You see the picture, it's actually a nice picture, it's been drawn by the devotees, where you can see her coming out of the waters. So Jamuna is there, and she's not appearing. Balarama is getting really angry. Whoa. He takes out his plow, Haladar, and he starts taking the river and dissecting it into smaller streams. Jamuna becomes really, really, really unhappy, realizing she made a mistake. With folded hands, she runs to the lotus feet of Balarama and starts offering prayers and apologies. Balarama is listening, and then he blesses her because she's humble and repentant. He says that if you do something wrong in devotional service, if you remain humble and accept the fact that you made a mistake, then that is glorious. Sometimes we make a mistake or do something wrong, we try to hide it, or we try to minimize the, oh, it wasn't so bad. I mean, I punched that guy, he deserved it. In other words, we sometimes take something we do that is wrong, and we think, it's not so bad. But a devotee feels guilty if they act in the wrong way. And therefore, if they remain humble and repentant, then they get the full mercy of the Lord. But if they try to hide behind some whatever, by the way, one tries to hide behind, then they remain in the wrong mentality and they can't receive that mercy. So Jamuna was like that. She prayed and Balaram forgave her. And then she offered him nice blue garments and many other nice gifts like that. And Balaram was pleased with her. So Jamuna manifests herself in the form of Kalindi. Kalindi is also another name for Jamuna. The Jamuna is actually the daughter of the sun god, Yamaraj is her brother, Kalindi is his brother and sister. Yamaraj is her brother. And the sun god Surya is their father. Okay, these are some, anybody have a particular pastime that you want to hear about Lord Balarama? Anyone can think of one? Yes, people. Oh, I was thinking of telling that one tonight. Thank you for reminding me. Yeah. Let me see how to start this one. Balaram likes to gamble, but he's not good at it. So there was a dice match between Balaram. Rukmi was the brother of Rukmini. And Rukmini wanted to marry his sister to Shushupa. But Krishna foiled that whole thing. And Balaram's armies fought against the armies of Shushupa and destroyed their armies and pushed them back so Krishna could kidnap Rukmini and marry her. Rukmini is one of the principal queens. She is the principal queen of Dwarka. So, but her brother, Rukmini, he wasn't so favorable. But so he challenged Balaram to a gambling match. And there was in one kingdom called, the king of Kalinga was also there. And so Krishna's there. Rukmini's there, Balaram's there, Rukmi's there, and the gambling match is going on. And the king of Kalinga, he's watching. And he's hoping for Rukmi. So they wagered, I think, 100 gold coins. And Rukmi rolls the dice and wins. So they wager 1,000 gold coins, and Balaram loses again. But this time, they wagered 10,000 coins, and Balaram won. But Rukmi said, no, you didn't win, I won. Like that. And so Rukmi tried to cheat Balaram. Balaram was getting angry. And then the voice came out of the sky and said, Balaram is the winner. So Rukmi, he's trying to defend his position, and he's getting very angry. Now, the king of Kalinga was laughing during this whole thing, seeing Balaram defeated. And now, when he's trying to cheat, he takes the side of Rukmi. So Balaram, I forgot what he did to Rukmi. What did he do? He punched him? He did something to Rukmi. He killed him. Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay. Easy. Don't worry about all the paperwork. And the king of Kalinga was laughing, so Balaram took his club and he says that he has a very bright smile and nice teeth. So he was laughing and Balaram smashed him in the teeth and all his teeth broke.
So you didn't have to go to the dentist anymore. And then Krishna didn't do anything. Rukmini was a little upset that her brother was killed. But Krishna remained neutral. Because if he sided with Balarama, then Rukmini would get mad. And if he sided with Rukmini, then Balarama would get mad. So Krishna would play it cool. He's like a cool guy. He's just watching. But I think in his heart he was rooting for Balarama. But he didn't want his wife to get upset, so he didn't say anything. That could upset your wife. Remember that, but for those of you who are married. You want to know what is the ultimate happiness in married life? Not ultimate, I'm sorry, the only happiness. The only happiness in married life. There's some happiness in married life, you didn't know that. There's a thing called oxymoron. You know what an oxymoron is? Two words that don't go together, like business ethics. You know, that's an oxymoron, business ethics. A small crowd, a happy marriage. That's another oxymoron. I'm sorry, but I'm just disappearing. But please, stay tuned, because there is some happiness in there. I'll get to the point. Rukmini, she wanted to somehow or other, Krishna wanted to test Rukmini's love for him by getting her angry, by putting himself down. So in so many ways, he says to Rukmini, my dear queen, oh most beautiful one, you had so many wonderful suitors that were more qualified to marry you, such as Shishupal and others, and you picked me. You made a mistake. You don't even know where I came from. I'm from a village of cowherds. I'm on a low class. You're a princess. You're royalty. We're just vaishyas. We just play with cows. So he's putting himself down in so many ways. And then he goes on to speak about, how unqualified and how much he made a mistake. But then he ends by saying, it's not too late. You can get another suitor. Now, Rukmini, she's not like Satyabhama. Satyabhama is Krishna's other queen, who's very feisty. When she gets angry, she gets really angry. Sometimes we name some Mataji Satyabhama, so you know. Anybody, I hope you still ready. Anybody here named Satyabhama?
There's a little girl named Satyabhama.
Anyway. Satyabhama, she loves Krishna, but she's an expansion of Srimati Radharani, who manifests herself in Dwarka. Rukmini is an expansion of Chandravali, who is sweet, soft, and very obedient to Krishna. So Krishna tried to do what he usually does with Satyabhama to Rukmini. It didn't work. Krishna blew it. And she's just getting dizzy hearing him do that. And she faints and says that just like in a storm, a hurricane knocks down a palm tree so easily, she fell over like being hit with a hurricane. Of Krishna's words. She's unconscious. Krishna realizes, I blew it. I made a mistake. So very lovingly and very gently, he picks up his queen and starts to speak sweet words. At that time, she becomes a pundit and turns everything he says around to glorify him. In such a way that every one of his words, so you can read it in the 60th chapter, the 45th chapter, 60th chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam, verse number 45 is the interesting one. So in that whole chapter, she's just glorifying Krishna over and over again. And then she ends in the most wonderful way. And here's where the happiness comes in marriage. So stay tuned. You won't hear this on the local media. So she says, What woman in her right mind would take in place of you some person whose body is made up of mucus, bile, air, stool, pus, and all kinds of foul substances inside and outside, decorated with mustaches and beards? What woman in their right mind would accept that person over you? Hare Krishna. So this is a very nice verse for ladies. You can get fired up about this one. And then, in the purport, it says that here is the happiness in married life. That somehow, if you could exchange some joking words with your wife, that's it. Okay, so you know, here's the secret of a married life. Joke with your wife. Aside from that, I don't want to say anything else because I'll be implicated on because we're on TV. So I'm sorry if I destroyed anybody's marriage. Please don't give up. But that applies to material life. In spiritual life, there are many, many happinesses together. In spiritual life, when you chant together, when you worship together, when you take prasadam together, when you discuss philosophy together, when you serve together, all these are opportunities for transcendental happiness. So that only applies to the materialist. So material life means, married life means, a few jokes and that's it. And that's about it. I know there's love there. We won't go into that too deeply. The subject matter is Balarama, so we're getting off track a little bit. Anyway, I'm sorry, I've been working too hard today, so this is what happened. Okay, so we have about 6 minutes. Any questions? I guess after that one, nobody will ask anything. Any questions? Comments? Lord Balarama? Tenth Canto, Chapter 60, Verse 45. Interesting. And translation. No questions.
About chanting?
About preaching. Can it be not about Balarama? It's a quick one.
Balarama, yeah, because by serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Balarama is, he's a person that wants everyone to become Krishna conscious. He's the original guru. So he manifests his mercy in the form of the spiritual master. So he, that embodiment of his mercy is the guru. So the guru, what is his main service? Is to uplift the conditioned souls and bring them to Krishna. So if you're preaching, you are really pleasing the Balarama. Same with Lord Nityananda. He was preaching on behalf of Lord Chaitanya. He went out and preached himself. He gave mercy. He used to go to the houses of the residents of Nandavan and beg them to chant Hare Krishna. And sometimes they would say, oh, Nityananda, we don't have time. And then he would get on his knees and beg them, please chant Hare Krishna. And then they would see Lord Nityananda begging them and they would say, okay, we'll chant. And would get upset with that. Yeah. So Lord Balarama, Lord Nityananda, is the manifestation of service to the Lord. And the highest service you can perform to the Lord is to bring others to Krishna. That is the highest service. There's no greater. So Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, what does he say? There is no servant more dear to me, nor the one will be more dear to me than one who preaches this message of Bhagavad Gita to others. So if you want to get recognized by the Lord, preach Krishna consciousness in one way or another. And then you get immediately recognized. Whether you're successful or not is incidental. The fact that you make the effort to preach pleases the Lord very much.
Okay?
So Balarama is that manifestation for compassion towards the conditioned souls. He's very compassionate. If you don't ask any more questions, I'll tell some more jokes. Okay, you need to stop me from telling jokes. Okay, yes. Sorry, Chris, but I'm sorry. Yeah.
How can painting be preaching, if you can? Hmm? What is the place of painting?
Painting?
Yeah.
That's preaching. Prabhupada said these are windows into the spiritual world. So when people see this, they actually get a little idea of the spiritual world. So painting is one of the really powerful forms of preaching. To paint Krishna's pastimes and the pastimes of the great souls. Yeah. You see, our temples are all decorated with so many nice paintings, especially in this temple. You're fortunate. You have some of the original priests in this temple. Yeah, we have a couple of the original, which is really hard to get. That one on the back there, the Harinam, I think is the original one. Yeah, that's an original one.
Nardamuni,
I think that is an original. The Sita Ram Lakshman Hanuman, yeah.
I have two original Pujapatras, that one, which is one upstairs.
Yeah, we have at least five or six different originals here. Very rare. Most of the originals are in Los Angeles.
Okay. That's
an original also?
Yeah,
it looks like it. Mm. Yeah. So these are the actual canvases that were done by the devotees. So that is preaching. That is wonderful preaching. You like to paint?
I thought it was a waste of time.
For some people may feel like that. But Srila Prabhupada has a different opinion. He says these are windows into the spiritual world. Srila Prabhupada ki Jai Param Jayanti ki Jai.